Hey, give a hand, hey, for,
give
the
a hand for the worship band.
That was just beautiful,
that was
wasn't
just
it?
Beautiful, wasn't it?
That was just
that
beautiful.
Was just beautiful.
My name is Jesse.
You Kevin,
there?
This is you yours.
This
is yours.
Trinidad. This is from Trinidad.
That's your charging box.
That's your charging box.
I forgot to give it back.
I finally remembered it.
I wasn't going to forget it today.
you're welcome. You're welcome.
I've owed it to him since March.
Who here
likes
taking
just a very
quiet
enjoyable
windows down summer evening drive.
Anybody?
You gotta get in the front seat with whoever you're driving, roll all the windows down.
And this time of year, the weather is exquisite, the sunsets are beautiful.
Well, last night my wife and I went to Cracker Barrel,
and we got out around about 8:30.
And it's just that time of year where it just feels good
as soon as you step out.
And there's something in the air that just smells like life.
So I was like, you know what? We're just gonna start driving.
And she's like, where are we going?
And she's like, where are we going? I was like, I don't know, but we're just gonna drive.
So we started going north of town.
Has anyone been up near the Ray Roberts Dam up there at the lake?
It's like a two and a half mile long dam.
And it's really impressive.
Especially at evening time when the sun is just kind of glistening over the water.
And we get up there, but by the time we got up there, it was about 9 at night.
Incidentally, if you don't have a Bible, you're going to need one. You can grab one.
And it's about 9, 10, so you can still see things just with your eye without needing light, but it's getting dark where you need your headlights.
Well, I've never experienced this.
I don't think anywhere, but especially not like the dam of all places.
And you know what happens whenever it's summertime and night comes and you go somewhere with a light.
What is drawn to it?
Bugs.
Well, we start driving and we come up on the bridge and we start going.
And I was like, good night.
We're going through like this. They're bigger than gnats. They're like mosquitoes.
Not that I know of.
But that's about the size of these bugs.
We're about to drive through. They must be like right here.
By the time we got through to the other side.
Now I'm serious.
I must have killed like half a billion bugs by the time I got to the other side of the dam.
It was so bad that I could not see out of my windshield by the time I got to the other side.
In two and a half miles.
And all you hear is like someone throwing little pebbles on your car as you're driving.
This entire time, and I'm driving, and I'm like, ugh, I mean, just disgusting.
So all it would do is go, and then it would spread all those bugs across. And as soon as it's getting dark, the headlights hit, it glares up all my guts, and I'm like trying to get out the window and drive, but they're like, going like that, not really. I mean, unbelievable. My license plate was entirely covered.
The Ford emblem was covered.
To give you an idea of how bad it was.
And I've never experienced this before.
I get out of the car once we get home and I'm expecting it to be bad.
I could actually smell the bugs.
And it smelled like dead fish.
And I was like, what have I done?
And it was just unbelievable.
The bugs that are there, you ought to do it. It's just unbelievable. Like, go up there about 9, 10 tonight.
And get up on the bridge, turn your brights on, and just start heading out. Don't put your windshield wipers on. And just experience it. It's surreal.
It's just another world of experience.
Well, the thing about it was, as soon as I got up there on that bridge, or any car for that matter,
Those bugs compulsively had to go to the light.
They would just go, and then the next one goes, and then, you know, hey, where's Steve?
They just compulsively had to do it. It did not lie within their ability to look beyond my car and say,
that is a 2,500 pound object with a windshield.
I don't even think I have a weight.
It's about to meet me going 60 miles an hour.
They had no ability to see past that.
But the thing was, as drawn as they were, as enticing as a light might seem to a bug.
What was it ultimately for that bug?
It was that bug's doom.
Like half a million of those bugs' doom.
It really was. You should go out there tonight.
Go to Proverbs 6.
Solomon is going to show us some headlights that a few different groups of people are drawn to.
That will be their doom if they encounter it.
It will be your doom.
But last week we introduced the book of Proverbs, and we're just going to bounce around a little bit.
So you got to have your thinking caps on.
Reading eyes ready.
Listening ears turned all the way up.
Last week, this is the underlying assumption of the book. If you don't get this, you don't get the book.
Wisdom is gained only through relationship with God.
Our next one is there.
But wisdom is gained only through relationship with God.
There we are.
Proverbs 1:7.
The fear of the Lord, the reverence, the worship, the awe of God is the beginning of knowledge.
If you do not have a right view of God, a worshipful, reverent view of God, you receive no knowledge, you receive no wisdom.
That is the assumption of the book. It's the beginning of the book of Proverbs, the end of the book of Ecclesiastes, the summation, or the end of all things, fear God and keep his commandments.
That's the beginning of Proverbs, the end of Ecclesiastes.
Now, chapter 6 of Proverbs.
We're going to see a specific headlight that people are drawn to. This is one that I'm particularly drawn to.
And sometimes it has worked out to be my doom.
Well, let's just look at it.
Let's go to verses 1 through 5. We'll read it and then we'll look at it.
My son,
if you have become surety or guarantee for your neighbor,
you have shaken hands.
For a stranger,
if you have been snared with the words of your mouth,
do this, my son, and deliver yourself.
Since you have come into the hand of your neighbor, go.
Humble yourself and plead with your neighbor.
Give no sleep to your eyes, nor slumber to your eyelids.
Deliver yourself like a gazelle from the hunter's hand.
And like a bird from the hand of the fowler.
Now, your first group, we're going to see five groups today, of things or headlights that's brought to, tended to, is this.
Group one is over promisers.
You can go to the next slide.
What do I mean by over promisers?
Jesus talks about this a lot.
He says, do not swear by heaven, because that is the dwelling place of God. Do not swear by Jerusalem, because that is the city of the great king.
Do not swear by earth, because it is the footstool of God.
Do not even swear by the hairs on your head,
because you cannot control whether they are white or brown.
Simply let your, what is it?
I heard it over here.
Maybe.
Simply let your yes be yes.
And your no.
No.
What does he mean by that?
Don't promise something that you cannot deliver.
This is the warning.
Do not promise what you cannot deliver. In fact, in verses 1 and 2,
my son, if you become surety for your neighbor, this is what this is.
This is what this is. You have a neighbor, and he says, hey, bro, I need 40 bucks.
$40 for this camel that I want to get.
And you say, okay, I'll put up that money for you.
Here it is.
You basically become indebted for your neighbor.
Or you receive a debt for your neighbor.
And then the second part of verse 1 is is
not only
maybe it's your neighbor, but maybe you've promised something that you cannot deliver for a stranger.
This is something that I struggle with.
I think this is something that our culture struggles with at large.
Because this does not only have to do with money.
Even though that's a large part of it, seeing as the U.S. debt is $22.6 trillion,
an all-time national high.
Yeah, yeah.
It doesn't have to do only with money, but it also has to do with relationships.
Our culture is in a fascinating time.
Because what it does is it makes you promise things to people.
Like friendship.
If you have an Instagram, raise your hand.
Whoever has an Instagram, whoever has more than 500 followers.
It's okay to raise your hand.
Nikki's like, I'm verified.
Nikki's like, that's the wrong one, probably.
I don't know.
I deleted mine, so I can't remember the terms.
Who here has a Facebook?
Raise your hand.
You're like, my mom does, but not me.
Well, in all of these social media platforms, we're called to be friends or followers of hundreds of people.
And it gives us the illusion of companionship and friendship.
Whenever it is actually not there.
And we cannot deliver. It has made us overpromise and underdeliver.
Can this be used of financial things, student loans, whenever you go to college?
Absolutely.
So for y'all graduating, the average debt for a college senior about to graduate is $26,000.
You're not notching above 24 years old at that point, and you're looking at the minimum 10-year payoff.
Looking like 15, which means you are indebted to someone for 15 years.
That's big stuff.
So we are the most in debt society in history.
And we are the most overcommitted and under-delivering society.
We wonder why we're the most anxiety-filled society in history.
He says, if you've been snared with the words of your mouth,
do this.
The warning is, don't promise what you can't deliver.
Proverbs 17.
Even a fool is considered wise when he remains silent.
It's better to be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt.
It's better to be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt.
Even the fool is considered wise when he remains silent.
Proverbs 29:20.
Do you see a man of many words?
Poverty will soon follow.
So don't overpromise.
That's why James says,
Let all of you be quick to listen, slow to speak.
Don't let your mouth get you in trouble.
James also says the tongue is a fire.
See how great a forest is set ablaze by a single spark.
Well, incidentally, anyone here a John Wayne fan?
I'm a John Wayne fan.
I see y'all.
There's a movie called The Cowboys, and he has to get these teenagers to help him drive cattle thousands of miles.
And there's this one guy, Cimarron,
who is just kind of a wild cat.
And he can't be tamed by anybody.
He's big talk, I'll fight you, I'll cut you, I'll do whatever.
And John Wayne just kind of slaps him, throws him in a bucket of water.
And with that iconic voice, he says,
Big talk, don't make a big man.
And that's the same thing that Solomon is talking here in Proverbs.
Just because you talk big doesn't mean you can walk big.
Don't overpromise what you can't deliver.
The cure.
Verses 3 through 4.
If you're caught in this situation, if you're indebted to someone,
if you have gotten yourself into a situation where you are snared, Do this to deliver
do
yourself.
Do this to deliver yourself.
Come into
the hand of
your
neighbor.
Go.
Humble yourself.
Humble yourself.
And importune
or plead with your neighbor.
It's humility.
It's humility and a plea.
Humility and a plea.
Humility and a plea.
You say, well, why can't
I just work
my way out of it?
Well,
in so many situations that we get stuck in,
whose fault was it that got us there?
Somebody hit me with that answer.
Whose fault was it if I am in debt?
Let's just use the example of finance.
Whose fault is that?
It is my own.
If I am in debt.
So
Solomon is saying, you got yourself into this.
Do you really think you're going to work your way out of this?
Incidentally, this is what Adam and Eve did.
In the garden, after they sinned.
In the original sin, Genesis 3.
What did they do? Did they go and fall before the feet of God and humble themselves and plead for mercy?
No.
They cover themselves.
And then they hide.
We do the same thing.
That is what happens whenever we try and get ourselves out of a mess that we created.
He says, rather humble yourself and go and plead with your neighbor to let you out of it.
I cannot be a man of my word.
It is more of a man of your word, acknowledging that you can't, continually saying that you can't, and never doing it.
Does that make sense?
Verse 4.
Give no sleep to your eyes, nor slumber to your eyelids.
Deliver yourself like a hunter's hand, and like a bird from the hand of a fowler.
Now, a fowler is someone who catches birds, he's a bird hunter, basically.
Now, why is the idea of indebtedness so crucial here?
I think in all of Scripture.
Well, there's a few things.
If you are indebted to someone, you owe people favors, you owe people money.
You owe people things that you promised them you cannot deliver on.
Well, who here would enjoy in your future a healthy, vibrant marriage?
I'm sure most of y'all would enjoy an enjoyable time at a college of your choice.
Most of y'all.
Or you might say, I would like a good job.
I would like a family.
Well, all of those things are affected by the way we intertwine or are either in debt or not with someone or something.
Indebtedness is a huge theme.
Paul says this.
Well, you can use this verse.
The wages of sin is death.
Now, what is wages?
It is payment for something.
So you could read the verse like this.
The wages, or the payment for what God requires, to the debt of my sin is death.
James, let no one say when he is being tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God himself tempts no one and cannot be tempted.
Rather, when we are tempted, we are lured and drawn away by our own desire.
It is our problem that has gotten us there.
Humility and a plea.
That's the only thing.
The cure in verse five, or the danger of this topic, is that payment is required with debt.
Whether it's relational, you're indebted to someone because you made a promise, financial, because you took out something that you can't pay back, or it is spiritual.
You said, I will earn my way to God.
Payment must be rendered.
That's why in Colossians 2, Paul says, through the cross of Christ
and the blood of Jesus,
He has canceled our debt.
Amen. By nailing it to the tree.
He has canceled our debt.
Now, why do I want to be free from all men?
Because of this.
I am already owned by someone.
You are indebted to someone, and you are in a sense obligated to that person.
You get a paycheck.
That paycheck is not yours.
It is obligated to whoever you owe.
Now,
Lost my train of thought.
It's gone.
It's gone like that bug.
It's gone like that bug.
Oh, yes. Oh,
there
yes.
There we go. There we go.
I am owned.
Paul says in 1 Corinthians 7.
You are bought with a price.
With the price of the blood of the Son of God.
And that's why Paul in Romans 13 says,
Pay what you owe. Taxes are due. Honor is due.
Honor is due.
And do this. Owe nothing to anyone.
So that you can love.
Because love is not compelled.
Love is voluntary.
I will offer you my love.
It is not compelled.
Owe nothing to anyone so that you can love.
That's the ultimate problem. If I am indebted to someone else, and I am obligated to that person, and now my love is controlled.
Paul says, get out there.
Deliver yourself like a gazelle.
Are you in debt, incidentally?
Is there something in your life that has authority over you?
I am too.
It's probably not money at this point.
It might be.
But are you in debt to a thing, an addiction?
Does a video game have control of your life? Does gossip have control of your life?
Does sin have control of your life?
Jesus says, the truth shall set you free.
Come to him. Second group. Let's look at this.
There's a word that I could use, but I just thought it would be more fun this way.
Go to your next slide.
They are under deliverers.
I could have used underachievers.
I could have used overachievers. I just thought this was more fun.
With the ers.
Verses 6 through 8.
We're going to see what it means.
Go to the ant, observe her ways, and be wise.
Which having no chief officer or ruler prepares her food in the summer and gathers her provision in the harvest.
Now, whenever you see the word sluggard in Proverbs,
that has to do with someone who was lazy.
Elsewhere in Proverbs it says the sluggard dips his hand into his bowl and does not bring it back to his mouth.
Basically, he's so lazy that he says, how can I exasperate myself to bring my hand to my mouth and feed me?
So now there's a different headlight going down the Ray Roberts Dam. And there's a different bug that goes, bzzz, here's a new light. And it is laziness. Some might call it slothfulness. Laziness. What does he say to him? Well, he gives him a cure first. He says, go to something. Go to an ant. This is the beautiful thing about Proverbs is he can teach you things through an insect. That's the wisdom of Solomon. He says, hey, look at this bug, and I want you to learn how your life should be through this bug. That is being able to see life and learn. Well, what about the bug? He says, look, having no chief officer or ruler, meaning there's no person barking orders saying, hey, go pick up food. Go bring it back to the hive. Go bring it back to the mound. Go do it. Go. Come on. The ant doesn't need any sort of exhortation or any sort of cattle prod, like a little zzz, zzz, come on. Because the ant knows that summer will come and pass, fall will come and pass, and there will be winter. And there will be no more food, and that ant will starve. So he says, the ant prepares, in verse 8, prepares her food in the summer and gathers her provision in harvest. Prepares for the future in the present. And the ant is diligent. He says, look, sluggard. Look to the ant. This is what you do. And incidentally, here is the danger of the sluggard. Look at verses 9 and 11. How long will you lie down, O sluggard? When will you arise from your sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest? What harm could it do to just sleep in a little bit longer, to go back home and take another nap? Those chores, that task, that job will get done another day. But here's the danger. Look at verse 11.
Your poverty will come in like a vagabond, like a beggar, and your need like an armed man. Basically, you're going to sit there in laziness, you're going to sit there in laziness, and you say, it'll get done, and then you're going to wind up sitting there with nothing and hungry, and you have no idea how to fix it. And he says, this is what's happening. Self-destruction. That's the danger. Your ability to provide for yourself has atrophied. Like a muscle, if you don't work it out, it shrinks. He says, you're going to shrink. And then hunger is going to come in like an armed soldier. It's going to beat you up, and it's going to take all your stuff and leave. But you're not going to know it until it happens. So look to the ant. Look to it. Don't be undisciplined. The righteous has enough to fill his appetite, but the belly of the fool suffers want. That's Proverbs 13. Let's look to our third group. Third group. This is interesting. He takes an interesting twist. He kind of, now, you might be one of these. You might be a little bit of all of these. I have seen myself throughout this week and preparing this, that there's a little bit of me in each of these groups. Well, the third group is this. They're proud walkers. Proud walkers. Verse 12, a worthless person, a wicked man, is the one who walks with a perverse mouth, who winks with his eyes, who signals with his feet, who points with his fingers, who with perversity in his heart continually devises evil, who spreads strife. Now you say, that's weird. What does winking with your eyes mean and signaling with your feet? Like, basically what the author has done is he said, this type of person, every ability that they have, whether it's the movement of their eyes and winking at someone with scandal, it's the movement of their hands and their gesture, it's the words that they speak from their mouth, it's the things that they do with their hands and their feet, every aspect of them has been corrupted. Corrupted. And they walk in arrogance. They walk in arrogance. Arrogance. Then not only then this one, not only this one, so the first two are kind of incidental.
I've bumped into a bad situation due to my error.
Now you have someone who is malicious.
Now you have someone.
From verse 14, who is a bully. He devises evil and spreads strife. He spreads strife. And what is the danger? Go to your next slide. What's the danger of this one? Intended injury of another.
This is dangerous.
The intended injury of another.
It's a dangerous game.
Someone who devises in his mind evil.
You use your mind and your heart to devise something that causes ill to another.
Well, this is the warning. Verse 15. Look at this. Therefore, his calamity or his downfall, his destruction, will come suddenly. Instantly, he will be broken and there will be no healing. What's the danger? Or what's the warning? You live by the sword, you die by the sword. There's a movie, I'm sure you've heard a reference, it's called Lonesome Dove. And there's these Texas Rangers and they're law-fighting cowboys and law-correcting cowboys. Well, there's a guy among them, and his name is Jake Spoon. Well, Jake Spoon has a little bit of a gambling problem. And he gambles and he gambles, and you gamble in saloons, you get around the wrong people. And he gets around a band of people who are outlaws. And they're not, he thinks that they're just robbers, but his conscience is slowly being desensitized. Well, they're actually pretty bad men. They come up at these rancher's house, and they end up killing this rancher's family just for the sport of it. And brutally killing them. Now, Jake Spoon didn't participate. He didn't help kill them. But Jake Spoon didn't leave. He stayed there. Well, Jake's other friends, who are the Texas Rangers, they track down whoever did this because they come up on the scene of the dead family. And they're going to track them down, and they're going to bring somebody to justice. Well, they end up finding out that it's their good buddy Jake. And all of them have to face the gallows. They have to face the noose because they all ruthlessly murdered an innocent family. And they include Jake with the people that have to hang. And Jake says, "Hey, I didn't do no wrong. I didn't help him out." And Augustus McCrae answers with a famous line. He says, "Jake, you crossed the line." "I didn't see no line." "You ride with an outlaw, you die with an outlaw." Verse 15, "You live like an outlaw, you die like one. Therefore, his calamity will come suddenly. Instantly, he will be broken, and there will be no healing." Incidentally, the principles of this book are applicable to your immediate situation and your eternal one. Because sometimes there are bad men that live long lives. But 1,000 years are like a day to the Lord, and a day like 1,000 years. God watches, and he will take every act into judgment. Jesus says every careless word will be brought into judgment. Whether it was a whisper or a thought, it will be brought into judgment. That is why I need the canceling debt of the cross. Because there's continual evil in my mind. There's continual evil in yours. Jesus says, if you think of your brother as a fool, if you look at a woman with lust in your heart, you're guilty of the law. You're in danger of judgment and fire. I need the cross to cancel my debt. Well, that's the warning. You live by the sword, you'll die by it. Now, the next slide is clarification of righteousness. This is an incredible passage. I want you to encircle this, and I want you to think on this throughout the week. Whenever we're going through the Proverbs challenge or you're reading it, dwell on this, each sentence. And you've probably heard this before. Verse 16, "There are 6 things which the Lord hates, yes, 7 which are an abomination to him." He's going to give you a clarification of righteousness through negative example. Clarification. Verse 17, "Haughty eyes," that means like proud eyes, eyes that are lifted up and are subjected to no authority. "A lying tongue," that's deceit. "Hands that shed innocent blood," that's violence. "A heart that devises wicked plans," that's conceit. "Feet that run rapidly to evil," the enjoyment of evil. "A false witness who utters lies," and "one who spreads strife among brothers." You just saw a list of 7 things which are an abomination to God. 7 things that are an abomination to God. Now, you're probably guilty of a few of those in there, and I am too. But whenever I read that passage, I'm filled with delight. And it brings me joy because I see this. I see the beauty of God. The beauty of God, part of it is this, is that he is opposed to the ugliness of evil. Violently opposed. There is a reason why God destroys his enemies. Why God is wrathful when it comes to sin is because he is opposed to the ugliness of evil. And there is no way in the world that he could be good if he was not opposed to the ugliness of evil. It's a clarification of righteousness. Solomon says, just in case you forgot, here is the holiness of God. Here it is. Well, let's look at group 4. And this is a lot of fun. And we're almost there. Group 4, I just named navigators. Start in verse 20. "My son, observe the commandment of your father, and do not forsake the teaching of your mother." And remember, wisdom is experienced instruction from the previous generation. That is biblical wisdom. "Bind them continually on your" what? On your heart. On your heart. We'll get back to that idea. "Bind them continually on your heart. Tie them around your neck. When they walk about, they will guide you. When you sleep, they will watch over you. When you awake, they will talk to you. Wisdom will counsel you as you live." It'll be there. It'll give you what you need. Verse 23, "For the commandment is a lamp, and the teaching is light, and reproofs for discipline are the way of life. He says, you'll keep your life this way. You won't die by the sword this way. You won't be indebted to someone this way. You won't be the sluggard this way. How can a young man keep his way pure? By keeping it according to your word. Psalm 119. They will guide you. When they sleep, they will watch over you. Verse 21, whenever it says, bind them continually on your heart, Jesus says, it is not the things that go into a man that defile him, but it is the things that come out of him that defile him. For from the mouth, the what speaks? The heart speaks. The heart speaks. And then follow the commandments, follow your wisdom for this reason. It helps you know how to navigate life, which way I should go, and which way I should avoid. Verse 24, to keep you from the evil woman. So it shows you now negatively, stay away from this, from the smooth tongue of the adulteress. Do not desire her beauty. Notice there, your heart, that is where it starts. Nor let her capture you with her eyelids. Jesus says this, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his soul? Did you know that when Michael Jackson died, he was $400 million in debt? And he died from a drug overdose that was administered by a doctor. And he died in his, I think, 40s. And then his soul was gone. And they had to sell his house and all of his belongings to pay his debt. And everything he owned was gone. Proverbs said, my son, there are things you're going to want in this life, but they lead you down a long and perilous road. Don't do it. Don't do it. What's the encouragement? Receive wise counsel or accept sure destruction. Look at verse 26. For on account of a harlot, one is reduced to a loaf of bread. You lose everything. And an adulteress hunts for precious life. You'll lose your life if you play with it. Now, here's our last group. Group 5. And it's harsh, but sometimes we got to hear harsh things. Viruses. This is a virus. Now, this can be applied to other things, but I'm going to keep it very specific. Verse 27. Can a man take fire in his chest and his clothes not be burned? Basically, can you play with fire and not be burned? Verse 28. Can a man walk on hot coals and his feet not be scorched? He's getting you ready. He's getting you ready. Verse 29. So is the one who goes to his neighbor's wife. Whoever touches her will not go unpunished. Men do not despise a thief if he steals to satisfy himself when he is hungry. But when he's found, he has to repay sevenfold. You steal a bread, a loaf, you have to pay back seven loaves of bread. Verse 32, the one who commits adultery with a woman is lacking sense. He who would destroy himself does it. Wounds and disgrace he will find, and his reproach will not be blotted out. The wall of shame is calling. And I want to use this as an example. And a virus is something that must be cured. Go to your next slide. The warning is this. An attack on marriage is the forfeit of one's life. Plain and simple. An attack on marriage is the forfeit of one's life. Now, I want to make this very clear. An attack on the institution of marriage and family is an attack on the very character, nature, and authority-based design that God has instituted from Genesis 1 and 2. Because an affair is this. Whenever God says there are two people and the two shall become one flesh, two very much lives shall become very much one. If I go somewhere without my wife, I feel half present because we are one. An affair, he says you become one flesh. An affair is the tearing of that flesh, and it is the death of that life. And he says, don't do it. And the way that you guard yourself from it is you start now. You start with, I won't overpromise. I won't be the sluggard in laziness. I won't be one who devises evil in my mind. But how can I do this? Well, the cure to this one is Proverbs 4:23. You can write it down, you can jot it down, you can turn there to find it. Above all else, guard your, what? Heart. For from it flow the springs of life. Spider-Man 2. There's a guy named Otto Octavius. And, no, sorry. No, we're talking about the Green Goblin. Forget Otto. We'll talk to him about him later. Peter Parker has a best friend. His name is Harry Osborn. Harry Osborn finds out that Peter Parker killed his dad. And he says, like, he's just filled with rage. This is Spider-Man 3, I think. And he wants to know how he can get Spider-Man, how he can get him dead. And you know what the Green Goblin says, who's kind of like the embodiment of evil? You know what he says? Does someone know it? The heart. First, we attack the heart. And then they go after Aunt May. Guard your heart, for from it flow the springs of life. How can I guard my heart? I must have a spirit of assurance, the very spirit of God, to make me think in a way that I never thought, to think the very thoughts of God after him through his scripture. Who can know the thoughts of a man except the spirit of that man? So it is with God. No one knows the thoughts of God except the spirit of God. And now that we are indwelt by him, we can now think the thoughts of God to protect us from peril, to protect us from danger. Which group are you in? I'm in a good portion of them. And if we're not careful, we'll get in all of them. Continue also with your Proverbs challenge this month. One chapter a day. I miss Friday. I'll admit that to you. But keep reading it with us. Our staff is doing it. I hope our leaders are doing it. See what God can counsel you through Proverbs. Father in heaven, as Justin comes up here to sing and as we render our hearts to you, I pray that you would guard them. Guard us from legalism. Guard us from overpromising. Guard us from laziness, from slothfulness. Guard us from intentional evil. Let the words of my mouth and meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, my rock and my redeemer. Find any hidden sin in us and bring it out. Humble us. Do not let us try and be humble, Father, but humble us so that you may be exalted. And through our weakness, I pray that your strength will be known and exalted. Father, we are weak and we are prone to wander, prone to leave the God we love. Here's our heart, Lord. Take and seal it. Seal it for your courts above. We pray it in the name of Jesus and by your Spirit. And everybody said, amen.
I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Thou art, how great thou art. And when I think of God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross. Burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take. Christ shall come. With shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my ears.